You're listening to a Dell Studios production. It was quiet inside TARDIS. Too quiet. Doctor Who had promised Susan and Louise some shore leave at the next place they stopped on Earth. The girls had hoped for London, but TARDIS landed a little bit out. Yet, to Doctor Who's credit, they'd ended up closer than they'd expected to. They arrived in a little village in Yorkshire on a cloudy Friday, and the girls sang their farewells, set out into the night, and caught the bus to York for the weekend. Doctor Who had decided to stay behind, of course, but eventually the endless hours of experimentation and chemical testing led to boredom. By late Sunday afternoon, he decided that enough was enough. "I must get out for a little while," he thought. "Embrace a little bit of the local culture, eh?" The girls wouldn't be home until the next evening, so where was the harm? He donned his fingerless gloves and pale blue comforter and set out into the village for some harmless exploration. It was quite a typical little English village. Two rows of cottages lined the streets uniformly, like soldiers at a parade, their white doors shining in the evening sun. Alongside the cottages, there was an old church, a pub, and a post office that doubled as a local shop. Very quaint indeed. The weather was kind for a mid-November day, with the winter sun dim in the sky, meaning that the air was frightfully cold. Doctor Who made his way towards the pub in hopes that there would be an abundance of drink and the possibility of some warm food. As he pushed open the door, a little bell tinkled as if to announce his arrival. Doctor Who walked over to the bar and sat himself down on the stool before removing his scarf and gloves. The landlord shuffled over from his conversation at the other end of the bar to greet him. "What can I get you, sir?" he asked, with a cheery grin on his face.
"I wouldn't suppose there's a chance of a cup of tea, is there?"
"Coming right up, sir." The landlord disappeared into the back for a minute, giving the old man a chance to take in his surroundings. It wasn't particularly busy, with some idle chatter between who he presumed to be local people and regulars scattered around the room. The pub itself oozed with that countryside feel. The whole place was furnished with wood and old furniture, and there was exposed brickwork along one wall by the fireplace. The landlord soon returned with a tray containing a cup, a teapot, and a small jug of milk. "Do you take sugar?" he asked.
"Oh, yes, please."
From under the bar, he retrieved a small dish of sugar cubes and presented them to the old man, who took seven. The landlord raised an eyebrow at this, but said nothing on the matter. Doctor Who sat quietly in the bar for a few minutes, sipping on his tea, until an angry-looking man stormed into the pub and over to a young man sitting on his own by the fire, before beginning a verbal brawl.
"That's the ninth sheet you've taken this month, lad. You better be telling me where you're taking my sharpish or there's going to be trouble for you."
"I'm not taking him," retorted the young man. "Mine are going missing too."
"Look, your land borders onto my paddock, so it can only be you. No one else can get close. I want them all back by tomorrow night or I'm going to the police."
He stormed out of the pub in a blind rage as the young man trembled over to the bar and sat himself down next to Doctor Who.
"What are you after, lad?" asked the landlord.
"Summit strong," he replied, shaking slightly.
"Double pint then."
He poured out the smooth amber liquid and placed it in front of the boy, who took a big swig and sighed.
"Excuse me, young man. If you don't mind me asking, what was the cause of that little kerfuffle?"
asked Doctor Who inquisitively.
"That were Mr. Wilton," he replied.
"He thinks I've been pinching sheep out of his flock, but I got nothing to do with it. As a matter of fact, mine are disappearing too." "Have you tried having a reasonable conversation with him?"
"Reasonable?" the boy laughed.
His family's been farming this land for over 200 years. That sense of self-importance has got to his head a bit. Oh, I see. Doctor Who muttered, frowning. Sorry, I haven't introduced myself, said the young man. I'm All, Jack All. He extended his hand to Doctor who shook it. I am Doctor Who. Your name is Doctor Who? Indeed. A little strange, but all right. Doctor Who smiled and took a sip of his now lukewarm tea before asking, So who do you think is taking both of yours and Mr. Wilson's sheep then, Mr. Hall? Jack's face suddenly fell, and he looked to his feet in what could only be described as shame. I shouldn't tell you, he muttered. You'll only laugh. Dear me, of course I wouldn't, exclaimed Doctor Who. Please, indulge your thoughts. Jack thought for a moment, and then he began to speak. I think it's a creature. Something that roams the dales that takes the sheep. I've seen summit. I'm almost sure of it. Doctor Who took another sip of his tea before turning himself towards the young man. Well, young man, I think that we should investigate this matter, he said resolutely. Are you pulling my leg? Asked Jack, slightly stunned by the old man's response. Oh, no, not at all, responded Doctor Who. As a matter of fact, I'm rather taken with this idea of a mysterious Dell creature. I should quite like to test this theory of yours. Right, said Jack, scratching his head in surprise. So, do you want to go now, or... Yes, a fine idea, responded the old man. He paid the landlord and thanked him for the tea, before donning his winter gear again and heading back out into the chilly autumn afternoon, with the young Mr. Hall just ahead of him. They hiked down secluded country roads for 3 miles before they arrived at the Hall farm. It was apparent at first sight that this was an old farm. There was ivy creeping up the grey cobbled walls of the buildings, and the tree in the yard was of an immense size. This filled Doctor Who with a huge sense of comfort. He liked old things. The sheep paddocks are squared up, called Jack, as he pulled open a large field gate on the other side of the yard. The old man turned and followed him into the field that contained the livestock. And this is where the sheep were stolen from, yes? He asked, gazing out into the flock. Yeah, retorted Jack. We moved in here about a month ago. Some sort of disturbance in the dales spooked them all. They stood for a moment, watching the sheep moving around the pen before Doctor Who began to speak. What sort of disturbance? He asked, curiously. Some low bang about a mile or so north, said Jack quite blankly. It was so loud that all the sheep ran home. It didn't even need to shepherd them in. Curious, said the old man. Very curious. Before Jack could say anything else, Doctor Who took off there in the paddock. He spent quite a while examining the open area, its stone walls and the old wooden gate being a point of considerable interest. Jack perched on the paddock's gate and watched Doctor Who, fascinated by his eccentric work. When he returned a little while later, Jack could almost hear the cogs and gears turning in his acquaintance's head, like an idea had implanted itself and set into motion. I think we should venture out into the dales tonight, he declared. You want to do what? Exclaimed Jack, turning to the old man in surprise. Yes, I think we should venture out after sunset, said Doctor Who, nodding his head confidently. I think then we might find what we're looking for, Right, said Jack, in a slight state of shock. Sundown isn't for another hour or so. What do you want to do until then? Doctor Who contemplated this question for a minute, before simply responding, Yes. Not long later, the two were sitting inside the farmhouse by a fire, waiting for the sun to set. So, who are you? I mean, really? Inquired Jack. There were no new cars in the village, and we don't get public transport around here often. Plus, you don't really look like a local either, no offence. Doctor Who smiled enigmatically and gazed into the fire.
Did you see a
police telephone box in the village? He asked, his eyes twinkling. Come to think of it, aye, I did, remarked Jack, shocked that he hadn't even registered it. Where'd that come from? It's my time and space machine. I invented it and I travelled from place to place and time to time in it. Jack looked at him for a moment, trying to process all of this. Don't be daft, he cried. Nothing can travel in time and space. Ah, but I can. I've travelled to other times and far-off lands. I've seen things you can only dream of, young Mr. Hall. The universe is a very strange and very marvellous place. The old man's eyes seemed to twinkle as he spoke ardently about his past experiences, and for the next few hours, he recounted tales of other planets, distant times, and pepperpot-like creatures whose primary goal was domination over the universe. Jack was enthralled. Not even the Hollywood movie studios with their large budgets and bags of spectacle could tell stories so captivating. The two could have quite easily sat there for hours, and indeed they did, with Jack quite happy to listen and Doctor Who quite happy to tell. As he told his stories, Jack seemed to come to understand who his companion was more and more, all the while still being slightly baffled. Time seemed to slip away from them like sand through fingers, as story upon story was told, and before long, day turned into night, and it was time for the two to venture into the Dales, to uncover the truth behind the mystery that had plagued them all afternoon. Being the local, Jack led the way, and the lantern in his grip dimly lit their path. The Dales were covered in a thick fog which coated the ground and seemed to absorb any form of light, making their lantern somewhat ineffective. This made the landscape particularly difficult to navigate, even for a local, causing the pair to stumble blindly over hill and dale, until they finally came to a stop at a small crag in the side of a hill, and waited for something to happen, supernatural or otherwise. The two must have sat there in the cold for an hour or so, before Jack spotted something in the distance. Look, Doctor, over there! He pointed towards a murky shape, lingering shy of 30 yards from their seats on that bone-chilling rock. I see it! Said Doctor Who excitedly in hushed tones. My, it's quite extraordinary. Do we go towards it? Asked Jack, both exhilarated and terrified simultaneously. It seemed at that moment as if the creature had heard of them and darted off into the darkness, causing the two to jump from their seats and scramble towards it in a frenzied chase. As they went, they were careful to avoid any rabbit holes or rocky mounds so not to lose their footing. Jack managed to stay 10 steps ahead of the old man, which at first seemed to be an advantage until he ran into thin air with a large clang, knocking him clean off his feet and stopping the pair in their tracks. Are you quite all right? Asked Doctor Who, offering the young farmer a hand. Yeah, fine, I think, he responded, taking the old man's hand and hauling himself to his feet. What on earth did I just run into? I could almost swear the way ahead was clear. The old man chuckled in delight before knocking onto the empty space, which seemed to create a tinny sound. My dear boy, if my hypothesis is correct, you just ran into a spacecraft, he said, smiling with satisfaction. A spacecraft? Yes, indeed. It seems that it has a cloaking feature, which seems to still be active.
Can you turn it off? Asked Jack, slightly bewildered by the circumstances that he seemed to be in.
Oh, of course. All I still need to use is my sonic screwdriver.
Your what?
My sonic screwdriver, a little invention of mine, said Doctor Who, proudly pulling a device out of his pocket. It was a little metal tube, no more than 15 centimetres in length and 2 centimetres in diameter.
It had wires draped and tangled around it, all held together with 6 brass rings, and had a little bulb on the top that lit up when you pressed a button on the side. The old man pointed the tool towards the patch of air that the young farmer had run into, and pressed the button, suddenly revealing a large metallic ship sitting there amongst the brambles and weeds.
But that's a spaceship, spluttered Jack. I must examine this craft, said Doctor Who, ignoring his companion. I think the results will be quite fascinating.
Without any further thought, Doctor Who took off around the craft using his little device, which was making a funny whistling sound,
to take measurements and readings for things that Jack had never even heard of. After a few minutes, he put the device back in his pocket and returned to where Jack was standing.
Yes, yes, quite conclusive, he muttered, gazing at the ship.
What did you find? Asked Jack. Anything interesting?
Oh, yes, yes, replied the old man. It seems that this ship crashed here about a month ago and is stranded. I believe that it must belong to our friend out there on the moors.
That loud bang.
Was this ship crashing? Yes. The poor creature inside must have been starved half to death. Thus the need to steal your sheep, Mr. Hall.
Jack pondered on this for a moment, and everything seemed to fall into place. The loud noise, the theft of the sheep, it all led back to this strange ship.
Is it broken? He asked sheepishly, the fear of asking a silly question.
Well, yes, exclaimed Doctor Who. I expect otherwise our friend would have proceeded to their intended destination.
Can you fix it?
Oh yes, quite easily. It just has a few disconnected wires from its power source.
The old man approached the craft and carefully selected a panel on the side of the ship, before gently pressing onto it with the palm of his hand, causing it to pop open like the petrol cap on a car. Inside the little compartment was a large silver cell with a glass compartment, which was filled with a strange blue liquid. Surrounding it was a mess of wires, all varying in colour and thickness. A few of said wires hung loosely inside, detached from any sort of system that would power the vessel. Using his sonic screwdriver and his spectacles, Doctor Who attached each wire one by one with immense care and skill. Once finished, he stepped back to admire his handiwork, and then closed the hatch. As he did so, the ship began to light up as power began to circulate back through it.
Good job, muttered Jack in admiration.
Before anything else could be said, something pushed its way between the men and slowly slunk towards the ship, stopping before the door and turning to face the two men. It was the Dale creature. The thing's features were quite wolf-like, with the exception that its eyes were a marvellous amber colour and seemed to gleam in the moonlight. It subtly nodded its head gratefully towards Doctor who returned the gesture, smiling gently. Upon turning back to the craft, the door in the hull swung open, allowing the creature to enter, before swiftly closing again as the ship began to lift off into the air, taking off and disappearing out of sight.
Well, said Jack slowly, that would definitely sum it.
Indeed, replied the old man. That would be the end of your sheep problem, Mr. Hall.
I suppose it would, aye.
The next afternoon, both men were stood outside TARDIS, wishing each other farewell.
I suppose this is it then, Doctor, said Jack.
Time for us to part ways.
Yes, I suppose it rather is, replied the old man. He'd enjoyed this little local mystery, and would be sad to depart the company of his companion, of whom he'd grown very fond of over the last day.
It certainly wasn't a bore getting to know you, remarked Jack, extending his hand.
Likewise, Mr. Hall. It was a pleasure to meet you.
Doctor Who extended his own hand to reach Jack's, and they shook it as if to wish each other the best of luck on their future endeavours.
I've got something for you, said Jack,
who withdrew a parcel wrapped in brown paper and string from his coat, and handed it to his friend.
It is some lamb chops, just to say thanks for your help over this past day.
Doctor Who smiled gratefully.
Well, I'd best be seeing you, Doctor, said Jack. I've got to go find some sheep to take to Mr. Wilton. Until we meet again.
Doctor Who turned to his box and walked inside, before closing the door on yet another marvellous adventure. He'd barely had time to sit down before Susan and Louise came bustling back into TARDIS.
Grandfather, we're back, shouted Susan from the doorway.
Ah, welcome home,
exclaimed the old man as the two girls strolled into the hub of their strange little machine.
How was your weekend?
Oh, Grandfather, it was fantastic, responded Susan. We had an excellent time.
But it's good to be home, remarked Louise, placing herself on a stool by a wooden workbench.
I'm absolutely famished. What's for tea?
Doctor Who smiled,
lamb chops.
You have been listening to Doctor Who, Tales of Time and Space, Doctor Who and the Dale Creature. Written, performed and edited by Rhys Dell. Music by Malcolm Lockyer and Bill McGuffey. Executively produced by